You're watching Tag.
Hello, viewers. I'm your host, Uzma Jafri, with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India, which has been consistently adjusting and revising its diplomacy to strengthen its ties with countries across the globe. Whether it is the neighborhood first or look east policy, the Narendra Modi government has ensured a special attention to its immediate neighbors. In the line of the same commitments, New Delhi recently hosted Sri Lankan Foreign Minister Dinesh Gunawardena. The two sides discussed entire gamut of bilateral relations and committed to widen the sphere of camaraderie in coming times. A report.
Sri Lankan Foreign Minister Dinesh Gunawardena paid a two-day visit to Indian capital New Delhi in the line of steps being taken by both governments to further bolster India-Sri Lanka relationship. The minister, who came with a four-member delegation, met his counterpart and discussed entire gamut of bilateral ties with the Indian side. Although there was no joint statement, but the visit was part of the major decision of reviving the relationship by both the leaderships taken during the visit of newly elected President Gotabaya Rajapaksa to New Delhi.
We have come as a follow-up in order to consolidate, strengthen Sri Lanka-India relations, and in order to pursuing that cause, we have met the foreign minister yesterday and ministers in charge of vocational and labour, and the discussions have been very friendly, cordial, as well as very fruitful, I would say. We are very much indeed satisfied and the outcome of these discussions. Sri Lanka-India relations will be more strengthened as we go along.
The relationship had gone on a descending trajectory in past few years as the island nation had been seemingly overwhelmed with Chinese influence. The relationship, which can be dubbed as new phase in Indo-Sri Lanka ties, commenced with visit by Gotabaya Rajapaksa within days of him assuming office. India had then announced a $450 million line of credit to Sri Lanka for development and counter-terrorism, asserting that terrorism is a growing problem across the world. Sri Lankan Foreign Minister Dinesh Gunawardena said that India and Sri Lanka are working together to combat the menace.
Terrorism is a danger for India as well as for Sri Lanka, and terrorism is a growing problem across the world, and especially in India and Sri Lanka we have given special attention and we are working together on this field.
Ever since the free trade agreement between India and Sri Lanka came into force in March 2000, the trade between the two sides has grown exponentially over the years. Thousands of duty-free products can be sent across the borders. The relationship, however, suffered few setbacks in recent past when Maitripala Sirisena administration tilted towards China. However, with the expose of debt diplomacy, Sri Lanka, like many other countries, has become cautious in making any such ventures. The new Sri Lankan leadership has said it will have special friend in India in coming times.
Moving on to Pakistan, where two separate incidents of minority persecution have unfolded in just 1 week. While the birthplace of first Sikh Guru, Guru Nanak Dev, was desecrated by a violent mob in first incident, the second case involved the killing of a Sikh youth in Peshawar. The incidents have further cornered Pakistan, which has often been questioned for its no-vocal treatment to minorities, especially in the light of a drastic decline in the minority population over the years. A report.
The Islamic fundamentalists, wielding sticks and stones, vandalized the Sikh shrine of Guru Nanak Dev or Gurudwara Janmasthan on 3rd January near Lahore. an incident that confirms the accusations of a widespread anti-minority sentiment in Pakistan. This site, which is one of the most revered sites in Sikhism, was pelted with stones by these youths motivated by religious bigots. The attack is the latest in the series of systematic assaults against minorities in Pakistan. The community was targeted on a number of occasions in the previous year too. The Sikhs in India say that the incident underlines the real nature of policies from minorities in Pakistan, which has been desperately trying to earn international brownie points by doing minimalistic welfare for the community.
पाकिस्तान में जो ननकाना साहब गुरुद्वारा पे हमला हुआ है हम उसकी कड़ी शब्दों में निंदा करते हैं डबल स्टैंडर्ड पाकिस्तान का दिखाया डबल स्टैंडर्ड एक तरफ करतारपुर साहब का रास्ता खोला गया दूसरी तरफ ननकाना साहब पे हमला
इट इज नॉट जस्ट द अटैक्स ऑन श्राइन्स बट अनप्रोवोक्ड फिजिकल असॉल्ट्स forced conversions and subsequent marriages have been embraced as new normal by Pakistani majority. 5th January 2020, just 2 days after the incident, a Sikh youth, Ravinder Singh, was brutally murdered in Peshawar as a result of prevailing hatred against minorities amongst Islamic hardliners. The brother of the slain Sikh has accused the Imran government of being a mute spectator in most cases.
Minority ek mulk ki khoobsurati hoti hai kyon aap logon ko pata nahi chalta hai hazaron lakhon ke jo funding aati hai karodon ke hamare liye safety ke liye aati hai government of pakistan ko isliye ye funding aati hai ki in aqliyaton ka tahaffuz kiya jaye chahe wo sikh hai christian hai hindu hai लेकिन तहफ़ुज़ ये होता है कि मुझे अपने भाई की बॉडी उठानी पड़ रही है ये तहफ़ुज़ है
पाकिस्तान्स ईस्टर्न नेबर एंड होम टू लार्जेस्ट नंबर ऑफ सिक्स इंडिया हैज कॉल्ड पाकिस्तान अ मेयर प्रीचर ऑफ सर्मन्स हु डज नथिंग टू प्रोटेक्ट इट्स ओन माइनॉरिटीज एंड देयर इज नथिंग रेटोरिकल अबाउट इट Pakistan has time and again given into the religious pressure. Over the years, the Sikhs, Christians and Hindus have been indiscriminately targeted in Pakistan. Their population has decreased considerably since Pakistan, an Islamic country that has shown utter disregard to its minorities, came to existence in 1947. Laws have been enacted by Pakistan government, but the implementation has been poor and there have been no signs of let-up. Keeping in view the current crisis, the government of India brought in an act last month ensuring citizenship to the persecuted minorities from Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. The Sikhs and Hindus who were driven out from the region have hailed the historic act saying, India is the true protector and preserver of humanity.
Moving on to the illegally occupied region of POK that has been misruled for years by an immoral coalition of civil and military rulers of Pakistan. There is an acute dearth of resources in the region owing to a constant and indiscriminate exploitation. The fundamental rights are missing and unemployment is widespread. Although there is no such exercise conducted, but analysts say the region will find itself at the bottom in the happiness index. The promises made before elections are never fulfilled. People here are reeling under abject poverty and there seems no light at the end of the tunnel. A report.
The people in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir are unhappy with the government headed by Prime Minister Raja Farooq Haider, as it failed to fulfill promises made during elections. The people say the region lacks development, employment and basic amenities like health and education. The illegally occupied region has been facing problems for the past 70 years and the promises that the current government made before coming to power were a complete hogwash.
इस मौजूदा हुकूमत को कायम हुए तकरीबन साढ़े तीन साल कार्स हो गया है, चौथा साल उसको जो है ना जी वो शुरू है, वो आगे की सिमत में सफ़र कर रही है। तो इस हुकूमत ने जिस वक्त ये बनने जा रही थी बहुत सारे वादे किए थे अवाम नाज के साथ, जो सत्तर सालों से लोगों का जो इस्तेसाल हो रहा है, यहाँ गरीब अवाम का इस्तेसाल हो रहा है, यहाँ लोगों को नौकरियाँ नहीं मिल रही हैं, जॉब्स नहीं मिल रही हैं, कोई इंडस्ट्रियल जोन नहीं कायम किए गए हैं जहाँ नौजवानों को एडजस्ट किया जा सके। रात को भी एक रिपोर्ट आ रही थी कि 5.5 लाख से ज़्यादा स्किल्ड एजुकेशन जो है ना जी वो जो नौजवान हैं उन्होंने बैरून मुल्क जो है वो तरजीह दी है पाकिस्तान की नस्बत। तो बेरोज़गारी है, गुरबत है, जहालत है और उसके अलावा मेरिट की जो है ना जी वो खिलाफ वर्जी हो रही है, यहाँ ब्रादरीज़म है, यहाँ जत्थे हैं मुख्तलिफ ब्रादरियों के।
Apart from facing numerous basic problems, the region is facing long hours of load shedding that has added further miseries in lives of small businessmen. Ironically, the region holds massive potential to generate electricity that could fulfill the entire demands of POK. The power generated through hydropower plants like Neelam Jhelum and Mangla is directly transmitted to Pakistan, which holds an illegal authority on water resources in the region.
हजारों मेगावाट बिजली जो है वो पैदा करते हैं, लेकिन हम ये देख रहे हैं कि हमारे शहर जो दारुल हुकूमत है मुजफ्फराबाद या इसके मुजफ्फात का जो इलाका है, इस सारे इलाके में जो है ना जी वो तवील लोड शेडिंग हो रही है। दूसरा जो बिजली का बिल आ रहा है हमारे पास, बिजली का जो यूटिलिटी बिल है, यूटिलिटी बिल में ऐसे बाज चीज़ें डाल दी जाती हैं जिससे जो है ना जी वो आवाम तो देने पे मजबूर होती है, वरना बिजली का बिल कट जाएगा, लेकिन उनका तल्लक जो उस बिल के साथ नहीं होता।
पाकिस्तान हैज बीन यूजिंग द टेरिटरी ऑफ पीओके फॉर इट्स प्रॉक्सी अगेंस्ट इंडिया। द पीपल इन द रीजन आर नॉट ओनली सफरिंग ड्यू टू लैक ऑफ बेसिक फैसिलिटीज, बट देयर लैंड इज यूज्ड फॉर टेरर ट्रेनिंग कैंप्स। Massive protests do happen time to time where the locals blame the incompetent and impassive rulers in POK who have left the region to be treated at the boots of Pakistan.
Moving on to the Indian Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, which has witnessed notable change and growth in just 5 months of abrogation of Article 370. While the Government of India has chalked out major plans on one side for the inclusive growth of the region, it has reached out and invited different countries on the other to have a first-hand experience of the improved situation. The tourism is gradually restoring its pace with colour and vibrancy returning to markets. A report.
Over a dozen diplomats from various countries, including the United States of America, visited Kashmir on the invitation of Indian government. This was the second such exercise where the government of India had reached out to other countries in a bid to bust the fake narratives and show them that the situation was heading to normal. In a similar effort in the month of October, the government had invited the members of parliament from the European Union. New Delhi says that it has been relentlessly working to bring a comprehensive growth in the region, and there have been tangible improvements in the last few months.
The objective of the visit was for the envoys to see firsthand the efforts which have been made by the government to normalize the situation, and also basically to see how things have progressed and how the normalcy has been restored to a large extent since the developments related to Article 370 in August, and there have been several steps which have been taken by the local administration towards that objective.
A number of restrictions were imposed as a preventive measure in the wake of abrogation of Article 370 on 5th August last year. The government has been lifting the restrictions in a phased manner and reaching out to common people in order to make them understand the real nature and objective of its step. Kashmiris who endured communication troubles and other restrictions are now appreciating the government's decision.
It was a free and frank discussion. What is the situation here? What happened and what did not happen? It was not a structured thing of something structured. There were certain questions they wanted to be clear on. There were certain things which we wanted to express what has happened, the pain we have felt because of the abrogation of 370, and that is all what was being discussed.
Article 370 was a temporary measure in the Indian Constitution that gave special status to former state of Jammu and Kashmir but kept it away from mainstream and robust growth of the country. The situation has improved significantly in 5 months of its abrogation. The hustle and bustle of markets has returned. The traffic is growing despite a sharp dip in mercury. Restoration of phone and broadband services has reconnected the service and consumer. Hospitals and government facilities are witnessing similar scenes as before. The tourism industry, which is the fundamental source of employment in the region, has seen a revival with the number of tourists thronging the region. It is not just the government, but the pictures are speaking for themselves and saying that normalcy is fast returning to Kashmir.
Moving on. In Nepal, locals are preparing molasses, a byproduct obtained after refining sugarcane into sugar. The dietary supplement is considered to provide numerous health benefits. Hence, the product is in high demand in Nepal during this winter season. Let's take a look.
Restless hands and soothing smell, boiling lump of sugar. This is what anyone visiting the ancient city of Toka inside Kathmandu Valley would during winters. Anish Maharjan and his family members are busy preparing molasses since mid-November last year, and they produce about 500 kg molasses per day.
हामीले दैनिकले ब्यान्दे बेलकासम्म 10 बोरा जति बनाउँछौं कहिले घटी 9 बोरा 8 बोरा नि हुन सक्छ कहिले 11 बोरा बढी नि हुन सक्छ हैन त्यसमा हामीले लगभग दिनको 500 केजी जति बनाउँछौं अ त्यसमा चाहिँ अब बिक्री भन्दाले अब दाइहरु हुन्छ तीन जना मार्केटिङको समय रन भएको अब दाइहरूले लानुहुन्छ मार्केटमा मार्केटबाट फोन आउँछ मार्केटमा पुरै दिन हुन्छ कोही 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 बिजनेस मान्छेहरूले चाहिँ यहीँ गाडी लिएर यहीँबाट दिन आउनुहुन्छ अनि यतातिर कोही कोही घुम्न आउने मान्छेहरू हुन्छ आउनुहुन्छ होइन आउनुहुन्छ यसो घुम्नुहुन्छ चाकुको बास्ना दिएर यतै आउनु कारखानामा आएर किनेर खानुहुन्छ त्यसै चल्दैछ हाम्रो मार्केट चाहिँ
The making of molasses is seasonal and the industry only works full-time for just 2 months in a year. Rest of the time, the people would indulge in farming and other supporting business. Molasses is prepared by cutting, crushing and mashing the sugarcane, extracting the juice and then boiling to concentrate the same. Many families consume molasses as part of family culture and also due to its health benefits.
अनि यो जाडो महिनामा चाहिँ हामी यो जाडो मौसमबाट बच्नको लागि हामी न्यानो बनाउनको लागि हामी चाकु खान्छौँ र चाकु उत्पादन हाम्रो यो 2 महिना हुन्छ हाम्रो यमरी पूर्णिमामा चाहिँ हामी यो चाकु राखेर बनाउँछौँ अनि यो चाहिँ अन्तिम चाहिँ यो हाम्रो यो पुष मसान्तमा हामी यहाँ यो चाकु बनाउने कार्यक्रम चाहिँ हाम्रो समाप्त हुन्छ अनि
25-30 वर्ष जति भयो मैले बनाएको पहिला अगाडि बुवाहरूले बनाउँथ्यो अनि त्यहाँबाट हामीले जानेर हामीले बनायौँ।
Unlike highly refined sugars, molasses contains significant amounts of vitamin B and minerals including calcium, magnesium and iron. It is believed to help in relief from stress, enlarge prostate, cancer, diabetes and obesity. During Makar Sankranti festival, people consume chakku, a sweet made from hardened molasses.
Festivities are the integral part of the way of life for the people in India, and every community has its own set of festivals. Each state and region offers a unique glimpse and taste into its way of life, rituals and traditions. Since ages, traditional Indian dance forms have been recognized and appreciated by the whole world. One such popular dance form is Odissi, which is the classical dance of Odisha. So today in our show, we will take you to the International Odissi Dance Festival, where this beautiful dance form was performed to showcase Odisha's vibrant culture. Have a look.
Odissi dancers from the world over gathered at Ravindra Mandap Auditorium in Bhubaneswar to showcase their talent at the International Odissi Festival. Each year, the event is organized by the state government with the help of Guru Kelu Charan Mohapatra Odissi Research Center, Bhubaneswar. Odissi dance performance by artists left the audience spellbound.
International Odissi Dance Festival is held every year continuously from 2006. So where all around the globe the artists they apply and they come to participate. This year also 400 dancers are there and musicians. If you calculate, it is the you can say it's a festival, a get together of 500 dancers, Odissi dancers from all over the world.
The 5-day festival was a confluence of Odissi art and culture aimed at celebrating the love for the ages-old traditional classical dance form. Apart from participants from states across India, it saw participation from England, Malaysia and Japan as well.
I'm an Odissi dancer, like kind of more like a beginning dancer, and I'm here tonight enjoying the performances. It is so beautiful. It is truly my favorite form of Indian classical dance. It touches my heart like nothing else does as far as devotion. Oh, it's so beautiful. The quality of the dancers are so wonderful and the theater is gorgeous. It's really a wonderful experience.
Here we performed about rain. Especially in rain, there is an the atmosphere is with is filled with romance and love. So here we performed the love between the two people, that if the female is in one country and the male is in another country. So the female through a pigeon sends message to her beloved to meet her, and she writes down all her feelings in a paper and sends it through the pigeon to the male. So that is our theme today. It was a very nice experience to perform over here.
Along with Indian classical dance forms like Kathak and Bharatanatyam, Odissi is also gaining popularity around the world. In fact, it was the only Indian dance form present in Michael Jackson's 8th single, Black and White. Odissi Dance Festival thus serves as a great treat for Odissi enthusiasts who come in large number to witness the astounding dance performances of some of the talented and reputed Odia dancers from across the country.
There's perhaps no better way to explore the vast cultural landscape of India than through its folk songs and dances. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching Tag.